with you all of you today. Please also allow me to deliver a warm welcome and my deepest appreciation to our distinguished guests, the Honorable Mr. Setiaji, Chief Digital Transformation Officer, Ministry of Health, Republic Indonesia. Thank you, Bapak. The Honorable Ms. Caroline Riyadi, Chief Executive Officer, Siloam Hospital Group. Thank you, Ibu Carol. And the Honorable Ms. Roy Jacobs, Chief Executive Officer of Royal Philips. And our esteemed guests and members of the media. Thank you for joining us today for this critical discussion, the dialogue Better Care for More People, Bridging the Gaps of the Healthcare in Indonesia. Our goal actually is to gain the deeper understanding about the challenges what we face in Indonesia, how we can collectively address this challenge, and we can come up with the better solution for Indonesia. As you know, in the last few years, in Indonesia itself, we have lots of the changes and also the transformation, especially for the healthcare. And we are going into the right direction, which is the focus actually is towards improving the care quality in Indonesia and prioritizing the new healthcare technology as well, like the artificial intelligence. And this innovation becoming the key to address this kind of the current healthcare situation and also to unlock the opportunities for Indonesia. And especially we, everybody having the same goals, which is delivering the accessible and high quality care. Philips, we have the long journey in Indonesia. We are more than 125 years in Indonesia and very honored to be part of this transformation journey. We provide the solution for our customer, the healthcare provider, and also the workers. We provide the patient solution as well as a part of the improving the quality care. And of course, at the end of the day, our intention actually is improving the efficiency, the productivity, and the quality of care for the healthcare provider across Indonesia. In the last 125 years, more than one decade, we are serving more than 1,000 hospitals, and we also do the training for more than 5,000 professional healthcare. And moving forward, we expect lots of the collaboration with all the stakeholders to make sure we are hand in hand to lead and also support the transformation of Indonesia. Building a sustainable healthcare is really required lots of the collaboration amongst the stakeholders. It's not only for the policymakers, the healthcare providers, academic and also scientists. We need to come together with us and also to make sure we can continue to support the transformation. Of course, at the end of the day, we need to give more impacts positively for more people in Indonesia. And I hope, looking forward to have a discussion with all of you. We need to have the valuable dialogue with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Astri. Yes, we are looking forward for Indonesia healthcare that can strive for more sustainable, equitable, and accessible healthcare system. We are looking forward for that, and we believe that we can. Thank you so much, Ms. Astri, for your speech. Next, we will be honored to hear the keynote speech from our honorable guest, Mr. Setiaji, Chief of Digital Transformation Office, DTO, Ministry of Health, Indonesia. Please give a warm applause to Mr. Setiaji.
The Honorables, Mr. Roy Jacobs, CEO of Royal Philips, Bu Caroline, Astrid, and everyone who is present here today. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat siang, salam sehat, salam sejahtera. Apologies from our vice ministers, cannot attend to these important meetings and asked me to deliver his speech. the esteemed audience, the world and the people living here are constantly changing, striving for betterment. As we progress further through life, it is through our natural instinct that we question the how to achieve more and better, or in a short, how do we transform from the present to reach the future we are aiming for. However, dreaming is far easier than doing the steps to attain that dream in the health sector. One of the main issues is the fragmented health data. Data that are scattered across hundreds of unintegrated systems and applications. This ongoing issue is difficult, as not only the number of systems are many, but they are all over Indonesia. You know, Indonesia have 17,000 islands, meaning hundreds of the systems are across all these islands. On the topic of Indonesia, being is the largest archipelago and also the big populations, more than 280 million people, we also have to address the connectivity issue. For example, primary cares. We have more than 10,000 primary cares, and then more than 700 now have internet access. The puskesmas locations usually in the remote area. So the one of the issues is about the connecting internet. Some of these health data are not even inside any systems because there are areas and regions in Indonesia that are still manually recording and archiving them through paper and pens. Although this practice may seem normal, but the fact that there is no proper documentation for preserving this precious data should be as absorbed as soon as possible. The main issue Indonesia is currently facing may be settled through direct approach. However, we also have the option and opportunity to utilize existing technology. We learn a lot from the COVID, how we can integrate it, labs, transportation, etc., using the COVID app. With this dynamic change of the world, so is the change in development of technology. By utilizing the existing resources and maximizing speed, overcoming these challenges would be possible. Over the last 4 years, we have become the very witnesses of the transformation in the health sector, specifically for digital health. We already have a blueprint till 2024, currently we developing in one till 2029. The government developed plans and strategy in order to fulfill these visions. Our visions in the first blueprint is how we can integration and development the health data, acquiring all the data coming from the health facility, and also how we can simplify the application because too many applications in the health facility. And the important thing also develop the ecosystem, like Philips and many stakeholders like hospital, etc. These visions are aligned with the dream of a health, data interoperability and accessibility across Indonesia. What we want is how we can bring the service to the patient rather than patient to the care, to the service. The government launched the National Health Information System, we call this Satu Sehat. Satu Sehat also we put in the high level of the regulation in the omnibus law. So the ecosystem of Satu Sehat, health data finally become synchronized, one to another. Right now, there are more than 40,000 health facilities across the country integrated with the Satu Sehat. Our aim is 60,000. So already more than 60% connect with the Satu Sehat. And then the people can access their medical reports coming from this this health facility. So this health data will finally become properly archived as well without fearing it being lost. The digital transformation of health services needed to answer the challenges we are facing at present.
with the collaboration and cooperation of the government, private sector, industries, academy, and also media. Of course, the people of Indonesia, we will eventually achieve the inclusivity and the effectiveness of our healthcare. Thank you. This is the speech from our Vice Minister. Waalaikumsalam. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Om Santi Om. Terima kasih.
Thank you very much, Mr. Setiaji. And next, systemic change in healthcare is needed to overcome challenges and deliver timely, high-quality care for all. Philips, as a health technology leader, has partnered health system worldwide and in Indonesia to address healthcare challenges with its innovation and also technology. We are pleased to have the CEO of Royal Philips, Mr. Roy Jacobs, join us today to share more about Philips' experiences and its vision of better for care for more people. Please give a warm applause to Mr. Roy Jacobs.
Thank you. Good afternoon. It's great to be here to engage around how to provide better healthcare to the people of Indonesia. I would start to give a special welcome to the Honorable Mr. Setiaji, Chief Digital Information Transformation Officer of the Ministry of Health Indonesia, the Honorable Ms. Carol Miadi, Chief Executive Officer of Sinova Hospital Groups, and of course to you all to attend today's session. I think it's important that we talk healthcare because we need to keep healthcare squarely on the agenda. As there are many competing interests in the world, we believe that healthcare needs to be a top priority for everybody. And we know it's a top priority in Indonesia, for the government of Indonesia, and for the people of Indonesia. And as Philips, as an innovation company, we want to help to drive systemic change in healthcare. And what do we mean with systemic change? Systemic change is change that happens at scale. And healthcare is a complex system. So if you want to change healthcare and better healthcare provisioning for people, you need, in our view, transform four axes. The first is you need to think about your clinical practice and how it delivers patient care on a daily basis. Secondly, you need to consider the latest technology to support changing the daily practice to cope with its challenges. Thirdly, you need to have the financial support to have the investments in healthcare so that you can support a growing population and a growing need for healthcare. And fourthly, you need also to have the regulatory system to change so that you also regulate healthcare in an appropriate manner. We believe that when you drive systemic care, you don't only think about care in a hospital, you actually start to think about people when they are still at home. How can you deliver prevention? How can you measure early on if something is wrong? And how can you then accompany people along their journey? That's why the digital transformation is so important, because you need to be able to collect data very early on. We believe that to make care better, you need to put people at the center to understand what is happening to the patient, hopefully before, when they're still healthy, and when they turn sick, how you can actually heal them. The other thing that we see is that care providers are under tremendous pressure to deliver more and more care to people, and doing that with limited resources. Because one of the big challenges in healthcare, one of the biggest challenges in healthcare, is that we see a patient population growing, which on one hand is a sign of a population becoming healthier, aging longer, but also because we have more chronic disease and we have more needs for care. But on the other hand, and that's no different in Indonesia, there are not enough doctors. There are not enough nurses and technicians to deliver care to the people. So you need to think of technology and different way of healthcare delivery to actually
keep delivering care in a sustainable manner. That's also something that we researched in the healthcare index, and we will come back to what that means. So this is a global issue. So we have a growing divide between the demand for healthcare and the supply. But if you look to Indonesia, actually you have an even bigger challenge, because you have one of the biggest populations of the world, and you have a very fragmented geographical footprint. So you need to provide care to many people on your 17,000 islands, which means that you need to have a very strong physical and digital infrastructure coming together to actually help you serve people where they are. And we know, and we are developing in partnership with the MOH, with the critical providers, to understand kind of what the needs are in Indonesia. And on one hand, we see you moving quickly, adopting some of digital practices that you are leading in the world, like you have your digital app for every person in Indonesia. On the other hand, we see areas where there's room for potential improvement. And we have that dialogue, because we see a future where we deliver better care to more people, where disease prevention is a priority for all communities, and where health systems can run more smoothly, more efficiently, and more sustainably when they become connected and better accessible. There's new technology like AI that gives new opportunities to support insights in the patient, diagnosis of the patient, better care delivery, and a more efficient healthcare. And we really need to ensure that we understand the workflows that are being used to optimize them through the use of AI. So when we think about how we do that together, I'm really excited that we see a strong ecosystem in Indonesia. So on one hand, we partner at the MOH level, but also with the key centers for heart, for brain, and for cancer, like the Harapan Kita, the Darai, and the Rama Sakit Pon. But also, we have very strong collaboration with the private hospital groups, like Siloam Group, which we have a many, many year partnership with, but also with Mandaya Royal. So we're thinking how we, as part of an ecosystem, work together to provide better care. We have a presence of more than 125 years in Indonesia as Philips. We have more than 4,000 people working in Indonesia as Philips to think about how we can better serve the Indonesian people. And I very much look forward to have the dialogue today on how we can do that together with the key players. But before we are going to have that panel, I would like to ask Asri to reveal the insights from the Future Health Index, the study that we do every year, deeply connecting with providers to give them their voice on the view on where healthcare needs to change. Asri, would you like to reveal the Future Health Index views? Thank you.
Thank you, Roy. Let me run through the Future Health Index. So for this year, basically for Philips, we are doing the survey, and this year will be the 9th edition, and it will be quite different. We are doing the survey. We are doing the survey for the 3,000 healthcare providers around the globe, and this is covering like the 14 countries. And basically for this result is not only doing like the quantitative research, but also we are doing the qualitative research, especially for the four countries like Singapore, United Kingdom, and also the America. Yeah, our finding is basically for the FHI 2024 insights. We come up with the result, which is there are three main gaps which facing by the healthcare provider. The first one actually is the staffing gap. The second one actually is the insight gap. And the third one is the sustainability gap. For the staffing gap, actually the number of the staff and also clinical actually is not sufficient to cover all the patients. And for the insight gap, actually is because of the data silo and also overload of the data. This also can be like the potential issue for the healthcare provider. And the sustainability gap, if we are talking about this topic, is not only for the environmental, but also for the financing to make sure this is, can be affordable solution for the everyone. Yeah, for the staffing gap, based on our research, basically there are three key solutions that we found out from the survey. The first one, actually, staffing gap can be supported and improved by doing the automation for the workflow in the hospital. And second, also the virtual care can help the hospital to do the to extend the reach as well. And another one, actually, the AI technology, artificial intelligence, easily can speed up the clinical decision making. For this staffing gap, basically, if we are looking at the research, for the healthcare leader, they need some time. They can speed up the timing for during, especially for the clinical data entry and also billing process whenever they do the automation. If you are looking at the data, basically for the billing process, about 65% of the healthcare provider already implement, and also for the clinical data entry is already 55% already implement. So by having this data, basically this is really a proven, which is doing automation can support the staffing gap. And also another data that we can say actually is the 100% of leader in Indonesia, they see the positive impact by doing virtual care. And this number actually is higher than global number, because global number actually is less than 90%. And we see virtual care actually can bridging the staffing gap, because it can be like a connecting the professional healthcare with the patient around the area. 46% can add the capacity to serve more patients, and 34% can be more flexible in terms of the doctor or clinician to serve their patient. Yeah. The other one that, sorry. The second one, the gap that we need to highlight is really about the insight gap, the data gap. And the first one that come up into the discussion actually, how the healthcare provider can using the artificial intelligence to use the clinical decision support. And the other one actually, they also using the AI to unlock the efficiency and also giving more insight. Plus, the finding that we have actually is seamless data integration is very critical, and we need to make sure the data actually is quite transparent as well and can be used by the healthcare provider. From this data, basically we can see AI actually is really increasing for the clinical decision support. About more than 80% of the healthcare provider using the AI is not only for the treatment planning, but also for the preventive care, for the medication management as well. Yeah, so by having this finding, basically in Indonesia, it's quite intensive using the AI to make sure improving the efficiency of the hospital. And one more information that quite interesting actually is the using of the generative AI The adoption is very high, which is about currently actually is above the average of the global. 99% of the healthcare leaders actually they try to infect, which is doing like the research how the AI can support them in terms of the workflow. And 74% of the healthcare provider is really want to plan to come up with the using AI as part of their tools, yeah, in the next 3 years, yeah. And basically, based on this data, the data is quite promising because based on our research at global level, the only 56% healthcare provider want to use generative AI, but Indonesia is quite high, which is 74%. Talking about the data itself, 98% of the healthcare provider also aware, which is the organization experience actually is really challenging because of the impact of the abundance of the data. And also they need to make sure with this data they can use it to improve how they can provide timely high quality care. And if you see more data, 25% actually they see the unnecessary repetition in term of the data inefficiency, 26% also making the clinical decision, and 27% they see the opportunity for the preventive care which is missed for this part. Let's go to the third part of the gap, which is the sustainability gap. Okay. Based on our finding for the sustainability gap, this is not only talking about the financially, but also for the environmentally, how to make sure the sustainability actually can be more affordable for everyone. So we cover the three things according to the result of the survey. How to achieve this kind of the gap, actually number one is healthcare provider need to have the sustainable procurement and also provide more investment in the green infrastructure, and second also the healthcare provider need to prioritize the reusable medical equipment and also renewable energy resource to make sure this is, can be like the green hospital. And the third one, according to the data, how to minimize the gap, actually, how we can improve the collaboration amongst the healthcare ecosystem. This is becoming like the critical. Talking about the environmentally sustainability, this is becoming like a more priority. It's not only to reduce the carbon emission, and also limit the environmental impact of the healthcare. By having the technology more and more, this can be achieved. And 51%, they are saying that they already implement the sustainability strategy. 39% plan to implement within the next 3 years. So this number is quite promising, looking at the nation also having the ambition to achieve the sustainability goals by 2030. And if we are looking at the findings, basically for the sustainability procurement is having like the highest one, and prioritizing to use the reusable and also renewable energy is part of the top three findings, how we can improve and also limit the sustainability gap. Yeah, I think the summary is our research, our survey for the Future Health Index for 2024 basically is covering these three areas. How we can bridging this gap for the staffing gap, insight gap, and also sustainability gap. Staffing gap can be addressed through the automation, virtual care, and also AI technology. Insight gap, we can achieve this, minimize the gap actually by using the AI technology again, and also reducing the inefficiency plus the data integration. While sustainability gap is really about the sustainable procurement, which is including the investment in the green infrastructure, prioritizing the reusable of the medical equipment, and last but not least, the critical of the collaboration amongst the stakeholders. That's all from our side. Hopefully this can be the insight from everyone and we can support the healthcare transformation in Indonesia. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Yakob. Indeed, healthcare needs to be the top priority. And once again, thank you so much, Ms. Astri, as she shows us that Future Health Index found three big pressing gaps, which are staffing gap, insight gap, and sustainability gap, which most of the solutions are through digital transformation and collaboration. And speaking about collaboration, that's why we held this event and conduct a discussion and focus about further better care for more people bridging gaps in healthcare. Health systems globally are facing increasing pressure to deliver accessible, high-quality care for patients, from unequal access to healthcare services to rising costs and health workforce shortages. People are now facing challenges to get the care they need. Indonesia itself experiencing similar challenges. Let me explain one by one. First thing first, rapid demographic, epidemiological and climate changes, evolving care demands, quality of healthcare and accessibility for remote communities need to improve. Urgent need to address the shortages of healthcare professionals. Accelerated improvement in health performance resilience is so much needed to close Indonesia's gaps and contribute to the sustainable development goals for health by 2030. And digital transformation is core to making health system more efficient and sustainable. And also innovation and technology have been pivotal force in Indonesia's healthcare transformation. Future Health Index findings announced earlier unveiled the health sector's perspectives on Indonesia's progress and aspirations for the future. So, what more can be done? What other commitments are needed to successfully contribute to better care for more? What role can each of us contribute to bridge the gaps in healthcare? In this dialogue, experts from across the healthcare system will share their valuable thoughts in this issue. So for that, I would like to invite Mr. Setiaji, Chief Digital Transformation Officer, Ministry of Health Indonesia, to come to the stage. Second, I would like to invite Ms. Caroline Riyadi, Chief Executive Officer, Siloam Hospital Group. Mr. Roy Akub, Chief Executive Officer of Royal Philips. Okay, so thank you everyone for your time. Really appreciate your time here. Thank you once again. So we already heard about the FHI 2024 by Ms. Astri just now. I would like to start the discussion with Ms. Carol. We know that currently Indonesia is facing a lot of challenge. As somebody that works on the ground, Ms. Carol, on the daily basis, what is your perspective? How is this truly affecting patients, healthcare staff, and the overall system? Can you elaborate to us, what do you see on the ground?
Thank you. Indonesia is the fourth largest population in the world. Our issue is always a supply side issue. We don't have enough beds, we don't have enough hospitals, not enough doctors, not enough nurses, not enough equipment. We just don't have enough of everything. And as we go into more acute areas of care, such as oncology, then that becomes worse. Then when we go out in the remote areas, then that gets even worse. We can open up access by building hospitals and putting in equipment, but at the end of the day, we need healthcare workers. And also the increase in non-communicable diseases, the expectations of patients also add to that burden. And we've seen that in the past few years that there have been quite a bit of investment coming in to the healthcare side, into facilities and into equipment. But what we see is the investment into talent and healthcare workers is really lacking. So then what happens? This puts healthcare workers under a lot of pressure. Increasing patients, as been mentioned before, rising expectations from doctors and hospitals and patients as well. And the focus then may not be on the patients from the healthcare workers. The focus is really on making sure they process through as much as they can. And then there's also burnout as well. We see that the government has been pushing on this to make sure that there are more specialists, there are more doctors that come into the system. We are also involved in the pipeline for nurses and doctors and specialists as well. And Silom itself, we adopt a digital first approach to operations, making sure we have a good foundation for our digital for us to build upon so that we can also bring a digital transformation in care delivery and also provide that transparency to patients as we share their medical data with them and they become owners of their data.
Okay, so with the data that you provide just now, how do you see Indonesia's generally the progress towards providing timely, quality and equitable healthcare for all?
It's a journey, and I think that it's not easy to generalize, and I think Bastian, you might be able to talk more about this because he does have the helicopter view. There are 3,300 hospitals across 30-some provinces in Indonesia. I think there are a lot of hospitals in different phases of this transformation, but I think that as we bring in, the first step to it is to provide the digital foundation in every hospital so that they can take advantage of technology and automation and AI that comes in. Now, I think this is a phase that Bastiaji is really pushing on, and so I think he'll be able to talk more about it.
Okay, as what Ms. Carol said, I would like to move to Ms. Osetiaji. It's not about only in healthcare business, but in all business now we have an intense focus on digital transformation. How is the progress so far in healthcare system?
Yeah, we already have blueprints. Yeah, we launched the blueprint 2021 from 2024. Actually, this is the end of the blueprints. And our aim is how the digital, especially the health tech, to fill the gap, as mentioned by Bu Karolin. Yeah. If we produce the doctors need a couple of years. So the technology will the fastest way. How we can, for example, the people in the remote area can access the doctor specialist using the technology. Because of that, in our blueprints, the first aim is how we can integrate it, all the health care industry in Indonesia, not only the health facility, but also telemedicine, startup, and others industry. 4 years ago, 80% of hospital don't have medical records, electric medical records, EMR. But now we have more than 90% of the hospital from the 3,200 hospital already have the medical records and also connect, including the Siloam. And then the second our aim is how we can simplify the applications. We have a lack of numbers of adopters, health workers, and then they need to input many applications. Because of that, we not focus only input one for the MR, make it automatically, for example, like LIS, just put in the sample and then the result can come in from the digital. And then also from back system, and etc.
Because of that, we need to integrate it to make sure all the people can access their medical record coming from this hospital. And then the last, how we can develop the ecosystem. For example, like telemedicine. Telemedicine is very important thing, but we don't have the regulations. Because of that, we put in the sandbox to make sure we can comply and also safety. The key is not only secure, but also the safety. Because of that, the progress, yeah, well, currently, we already achieved more than 60% integrated with us. We still have 20,000, mostly coming from the private doctors. Yeah, we already provide the system for free for the private doctor to use it to make sure that the government's support also from this side. And then the other side is about the doctors, about the digital capacity. Currently, we are going to develop the capability frameworks for the health workers to make sure they can use the system, because the issue is about adoptions. I think this is the progress currently for digital transformation in Indonesia.
Okay, so I could say now has been a lot of improvement. Okay, so how has it benefited to the society in your opinion, and
yeah,
how has it benefited to the healthcare system itself?
Yeah, the first, they can access their medical records, not only from the personnel, but also the doctors. Because usually the doctors ask to the patients about the condition of the person, like you have allergies, what's your drugs, drinks today, you have some issue about your heart, etc. Same question every you visit the doctors. So after we use the technology like digital, the doctor can access your historical. Our aim is we want to record from before your birth, from your mother's pregnancy, from baby until you die. So we have the historical data. So the governments can monitor your healthy ways, your sickness, the people's sickness, etc. Because our ministry is not for the sick, but how to be in health. So important thing is how we can have the data for all the people in Indonesia, all these people have got sick from this disease, all the people have seen about the cancer, etc. The important thing is how we can follow up the people or the patients going better or going worse. Till now we cannot this follow up because not have integrated. So after we can integrate it, so we can follow up, and then we can we can give you the better treatment. Because all these drugs not have some impact for these patients, all the people not going better because of that, so we can help the data.
Yeah, so simply because everything is now more integrated, so everyone is more monitored, we could say like that. So I would like to move to Mr. Roy Jacobs. As a health tech company working globally, including with Indonesia, what positive impacts have you seen from digital health transformation to date?
I think there's a lot of progress made, and I think the beauty of digital and especially AI is that actually in healthcare you can apply, and AI is helping today's practice as we speak. So many of the industries AI is being talked about but it's not being used. In healthcare actually you can use it today to schedule patients, to make sure that you have a better diagnosis, to help more patients, to inform the patient after they have gotten the treatment so that they can get access to the data. So actually technology is here to help, but you need to have the infrastructure. And when you look at Indonesia, what I'm very encouraged by is actually you are investing a lot in creating the infrastructure. What was just said is very critical. If you don't collect the medical data of your patient, it will be very hard to support them in a digital way. It starts with your electronic medical record. But then you need also to be able to access that electronic medical record from anywhere, because you have people everywhere, which means you need to be able to put it in the cloud. And access the data from the cloud. So do you build a cloud infrastructure for the country that actually you can use? And then you need to have your healthcare providers and practitioners knowing how to use in an easy and intuitive way the technology, because they need to focus their time on the patient, not on the technology. So we as technology company have an obligation to look how we can make it simpler, how we can integrate, how we make our systems open and interoperable. I think what you saw from the investigation that we did, I'm very encouraged by the fact that the Indonesian healthcare system is very open to adopt technology, because you can leapfrog. You can go faster than others. Sometimes it's because you have bigger problems that require you to think bolder and be more brave and move in a faster way to digital than maybe some other countries do. That is your opportunity to actually close the gap faster than some others can, because you're thinking ahead. And I'm very encouraged by the players, whether it's the private system, whether it's the ministry, also working together around that. And you need to have the digital future and vision that actually you will want to go there and put then also the investments behind it.
But if we talk about health digital transformation, if we compare to other country, what can more we develop in it?
I think the use of informatics in the daily workflow is something that really can help you in the practice, as well as virtual care is something that you need to be able to operate 17,000 island healthcare system. So investing in that digital infrastructure will be very beneficial for Indonesia to kind of provide care to many people. Whether you have rural areas or whether you have more central areas, because then you can also allocate your resources in a more meaningful manner. You can have specialized hubs in the more populous areas that actually coach and provide services in more remote areas through virtual care. So that doesn't mean that you immediately kind of need specialists in every single island, every single hospital, because you don't have enough of that. But you can actually use them, and you can more use other staff and junior staff, and then educate and grow them throughout the lifetime. And I think that's a unique opportunity for Indonesia to quickly make progress in the journey of providing better healthcare to your people.
Okay, and Mr. Setiaji, just like Mr. Yacob said, he mentioned about using AI, using technology, and currently our health leaders also aiming to embrace AI and data. This will create an opportunity, but also a challenge. Get along with that. Please elaborate to us, what could be the opportunity and challenge do you see?
Yeah, and I can be for our friends. Yeah. Okay, in our blueprints, the AI we already put in the blueprints in the app in the end of our stage. It's been 2024. Why we put it in the end in our building? Because we need the data. Yeah, after we collect the data coming from text space, images, drugs, etc., laboratories, etc. After this, we can use this to train the model and system. Currently, and also we have some issue about this AI itself, about the ethics, about the safety, etc. In the finance or bank, if you wrong transfer the money to other people, it can be back again for the money. But for the diagnosis of AI, after AI can be wrong to diagnose the people and then die, so we get back again. Because of that, the very important thing is how we need to more prudence, especially about the diagnosis. Because of that, we start from the non-clinical first. It's mean like how we can develop a model for prediction for hypertension. After currently, we already developed the models for prediction the hypertension. And then the others, how we can use this for targeted screening for diabetes, because we have some suspect, more than 90 million suspect for diabetes. If we do like a screening or a test for the 90 million is very huge budget, because of that we need to target the screening. So we developed the model for targeted screening for diabetes. After we develop model, only 30% the but the right target for the screening. And then the other side, we currently we work closely with the some hospital and ministry to refer inference the model. So we got the model from other parties, yeah, like the sector. So now currently we tested the models using our data to make sure this can be adopted by the doctors, because sometimes the doctors not accept this technology. Important thing, the doctors involved also in this area to validate, to make sure they can know about the model and to make sure about the safety, etc. This is how we adopt the model. We use the ethics from the WHO to make sure still use the people for validate, and then also to make sure this can be accepted by the doctors. Yeah.
Is that, do you consider that as a challenge or as the opportunity?
Yeah, we looking forward for the opportunity. Actually, this is opportunity.
Okay.
Because we can do a fastest diagnosis. Yeah. For example, about the one of the images for the lungs, we can detect more than 31 diseases. And then from the brain, more than 131 diseases. Yeah. From the brain, and then can fastest diagnose, because we have some limited for the radiologists, specialists, etc. So it can be more fastest way for the people get the treatment for fastest diagnosis and etc. To save the people in future.
Then how do you see, how would fulfilling this aspiration and digital transformation result in improving access to care, and how would this impact our health progress in Indonesia?
Yeah. Currently we already have 1 million prescriptions, yeah, from health facility, like a drug prescribed by the doctors. Maybe 3 months ago, we have some issue about the antibiotics receipt for the people. Sometimes the doctors not follow the standards. Yeah. So after this, we checked from our data, and then we have some wrong receipt there from some people in the private doctors. And this is one how we can prevent the doctors to give the wrong drugs. And then also currently, we want to combine the genomics. I think last month we launched the genomic, we call this Satu DNA in the Satu Sehat. So you can pharmacogenomic. Yeah, we start from pharmacogenomic. So you can give your sample for free to do the pharmacogenomic, because very important thing, we can know about your reaction for the drugs. Yeah. Sometimes the people only use the standard doses, but sometimes the people need to increasing the doses, or maybe half of the doses. Because of that, it can be more benefit if we have the data coming from clinicals, genomics, and etc. to make sure our people healthy in the future. And then the important thing also, our focus is not for curative, but the preventive. Because of that, now we also connect with the Apple Watch there. You know, our ministers already finished 42K marathons. Yeah. This is important thing to more healthy in the future. So we will do like a screening for healthy people, and then we got the data, and then after this, the system can recommend it. Oh, you better go to this doctors, etc. using the system. So the system, the application can be as a personal assistant for your side. Yeah, for example, if you eat some things, yeah, so the system can recommend it. Oh, after you eat the meat, after this you need to walk 5,000, etc. And then after this, we can give you gamification to give you like a vouchers or maybe for discount from the Siloam. Yeah, this is how the benefit for the data coming from health sectors. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Satyaji. I would like to move to Ms. Carol. What are your views about the next level of digitalization tackling challenges in patient care?
I'm very excited about the next level of digitalization because I think that the opportunities are endless. Hospital operations is very complex. It is very complicated. It involves a lot of caretakers, a lot of different professions, and so a lot of communication and coordination needed, and very little room for error, like Bastiaji pointed out. In reality, most healthcare systems are very siloed. There's a lot of redundancy in the work being done. I mean, how many times do we go to the hospital and the doctor asks, any allergy? And then the nurse will come in and say, ask the same thing. And then this another specialist come in and ask the same thing. And the pharmacist will come ask the same thing. I mean, this is a lot of redundancy that we can actually tweak out of the system. So there are many benefits from going to the next level of digital. The first one is automation. Whatever work is repetitive should completely be cut out of our processes.
Yeah, agreed.
It's absolutely unnecessary. And I've been talking to Phillips, Roy, about how we can connect our ICU devices that monitor our patients directly into the EMR, because in most hospitals still, nurses do a lot of charting. Every 15 minutes, they got to put a little dot on what the blood pressure is, what the temperature is.
Yeah.
That takes a lot of time. And so the staffing ratio for ICU is one nurse to one patient for a ventilated patient, one nurse to two patients for a non-ventilated patient. Now that's a very high level of staffing. We do this level of automation, can we then stretch our nurses to do more?
Yeah.
Or at least focus more on the patients? So that's number one. Number two is obviously improvements in accuracy. So there's a lot of double checking of medication being given. We have to do an appropriateness review, make sure the dosage is proper, make sure the route is proper. There's a lot of things that we've got to check. These things can be assisted by digital technology, which is what we've been implementing. But number three is also AI. I think that we've only scratched the surface of AI. Most of us in this room don't really know what AI is.
Yes.
We use that word, but we really don't know. And when I meet and talk with my friend here, Mr. Roy Jacobs, he tells me about the AI work he's doing, then I realize, oh, actually, I don't really know
what
the potential of AI is. And they've done a lot more work. But one of the ways we've implemented AI in a very real way is medical notes for doctors. So in the past, you saw our doctors taking notes by hand.
Yeah.
Now you go to a salon, you will see them typing, which is an improvement, but they're looking at the screen. You don't really know if they're listening to you when you're talking. And for us, it's a problem. Some doctors type a lot. Some doctors type very small, and they'll say just, patient is okay. Done. No more information, right? That's not so enough information for us. And so what we've done is we've implemented AI, and we're rolling out so that our AI records the conversation between the doctor and the patient, transcribes it, fills out the medical notes, populates the medical notes, and even suggests the diagnosis.
Oh.
Okay, these are the few ICDs that could be a match for this patient, right? And the doctor says, yeah, I think it is this one. Or, no, I want to suggest another one. So that does a few things. It frees up the doctors to focus on the patients and probably see more patients because mm-hmm. they're more productive with their time, efficient with their time. Number two, it helps us with compliance and documentation. Number three, it improves the quality of the data in our EMR, mm-hmm. so then we can do a lot of data mining, and I send it over to Pastiaji and San Jose Hub. So this is beneficial for everybody. So this is one of the ways. Now you talked about education. What's the role of education? It's important. I mean, we need to have a workforce that is digital and AI native, right? Like the founder of NVIDIA said, AI will not replace you, but you will be replaced with people who know how to use AI. So we need to have a digital and AI native workforce. Now, because most of our nurses and doctors did not grow up with that, we did not grow up with that, we're left with the task of reskilling a lot. Now, if that is embedded into the education and the training system for the healthcare workers in Indonesia, that will be a big help for us especially with doctors who are more senior and sometimes typing or navigating the system then becomes an issue. So yes, of course, that plays a big role in helping us in this transformation.
Yeah, that's why you are mentioning that investment in talent is very lacking just now.
Yes, investment in talent is very lacking. So my question is, how fast are academic institutions, including digital and more particularly AI, in their curricula?
Mm-hmm.
That's a question for us to be asking.
Yeah. I think it's interesting if you can answer this, Mr. Sadiaji, related to education and professionalism, professionals, healthcare system. Sure.
Maybe I will take a note from the Ministry of ICT. They mentioned about we need more than 30,000 talents in the precious metals in the forest. But the industry cannot can supply these talents. Actually, we already have many university have the IT, IT students, but only theoretical. We, for example, we open the recruitment. Many people propose their jobs, but only maybe only 10% have the good talents. Yeah, because the what we got in the university sometimes not comparable with the not aligned with the industry needs. Because of that, it's very need do homework in the future. How we give the more like courses to the student, especially for the next futures, especially for the AI. So I think this is needs for a collaboration between not only the Ministry of Education but also from the private to develop the talents. For example, currently we with some donors to develop 30,000 talents in the 3 years forwards. We do like courses to increasing the capacity, and then we do the courses not only the code but also the data analytics, and then the next maybe for the AI. So I think this is some of our targeting, how we will closely to fulfill this gap to give you more knowledge, especially the practices way, not the theoretical, to support the some industry.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Satyaji. Mr. Jacobs, Ms. Carol just now mentioned a numerous thing AI could do to help doctor become more efficient. Do you have any other perspective as a tech leader standpoint? How can innovation in AI and informatics help healthcare systems achieve their goals and address every obstacles in digital transformation?
Yeah, I think as we alluded to, I think there's a massive potential. If you take, for example, a cardiac patient, we can start with measuring at home if a patient has cardiac arrhythmias. And we have AI that's specialized in that. If you would identify that there is an arrhythmia, then you can actually send them to a doctor. The doctor actually can do a diagnosis. We use now an algorithm to increase the speed of the image taking by 3 times, which means you can do twice the amount of patients in the same time. So you increase the capacity. So not only you identify, but then also you need the capacity to scan the patient. So you increase the scanning. Then when you actually get the patient in the scanner, we know that the patient doesn't like to be scanned. He's anxious. He moves in the kind of MR or CT. So we have AI that corrects for the movement of the patient so that he doesn't have to retake the scan. But you can actually take one scan, first time right scanning. Then when you have the image, you actually can use clinical decision support to identify what is the problem with the heart. Where can you actually point the radiologist to that actually they don't lose time on routine scans, but they can go into the complex scanning. And routine scan, like Carol also said, actually you can really automate. So it's every step along the care pathway that you can do it. So that's from a patient's care pathway perspective. But then you look at country level. So we are discussing as well now with the ministry how we can actually can digitize all pathology data
Because if you have vital signs data, if you have images, if you have genomics, and you have pathology data, you have truly a database of the Indonesian population that can give you massive insights that you can pull from. And then you can develop algorithms specific for the Indonesian population. And that's very interesting for future-looking kind of developments in terms of specific solutions for Indonesian people. So I think there is a position in the workflow. You can think about the data play and the insights play. And you think, like Carol's thinking, about operational efficiency. Because there's a big capacity gap in Indonesia. You need to treat more patients every day with not enough staff and not enough resources. So you need to continuously think, what is it that I can do to become more efficient in my practice? And that's where AI has a big role to play.
Okay. So, Ms. Carol, Mr. Satyaji and Mr. Jacob, with a lot of questions that I just gave to you all, and we gain a lot of insight, then how can we collaborate in each of our roles across the ecosystem to reach our goals? I would like to start with Mr. Satyaji first.
Yeah. Actually, the governments for their journey is very open for collaborations, because the government can learn. We can learn from the COVID how we have co-working together to fight with the COVID-19 and get success. So we still have many diseases, many chronic diseases like cancer, TB. You know, TB, we have the second biggest in the world. I think we need in your capacity, for example, like hospital, so you can give your support for the best support for how you give the services. Yeah. Also, looking out in the futures, not only the patient sick to be your side and to go to your side, but also we can do like MCU in the futures, because MCU in the next future will be covered by BPJS. And then the assessor from the private sectors can support the ministry to, because you already invest in the newest technology, so maybe we can cooperate to develop or to implement the future technology to accelerating our digital journey in the future, because we already develop a platform to give you the space for collaboration, etc.
What do you think, Ms. Carol? How can we collaborate in each of us, our ecosystem?
When we think about the vision of what it means to have completely interconnected a world with different stakeholders, sometimes we think about all the things that need to be done in order to get there, it seems very daunting. But I think, as an illustration, I'd like us all to think about the first time we connected to the internet. What's your first memory connecting to the internet? You probably had to unplug your phone, you had to plug in your router, you had to turn on your router, wait for it to make funny sounds, and fingers crossed it would connect. Half the time it didn't connect. And then if it connected, then the internet also was very slow, right? And if you look at it, us now, where we're having our devices, it has interconnectivity, data from our provider, you walk into your car, then it connects automatically Bluetooth to the car, and then you walk into your house, automatically now notifications start coming in from your Wi-Fi. I mean, it's so seamless. We will get to a point where we are that seamless, and AI flows very naturally through all our systems, empowering every single decision that we do. Well, we are going to get to that point. So how do we get to that point faster, and how do we accelerate it? Well, I think a lot of bilateral conversations like we're having with Philips on how we can leverage their expertise, because they have a huge AI development team in sitting in India. We're not a tech company, we're not going to be there, but we want to leverage on their expertise. And so bilateral conversations are very important, but I think Pasiaji's role is the most important, because he's like the event organizer, that he is a catalyst for bilateral and multilateral conversations, and the orchestrator of everything. And so I think we support the government in this whole digital transformation. nation as a national system, not just a practice. That's from you, Professor Jacob.
So as I started when I gave the address, healthcare needs to change in a systemic way. And you can only do that together. And you need to have the different parts really collaborating very strongly. So you need to have the government, which needs to have a strong vision on financing, on regulation, on providing the platform. You need to have the providers that can actually push the practice, supported by the best technology. So we need to be open in our collaboration, not only how we discuss, but also in our systems and technologies. It needs to be seamlessly integrated with the EMR that wants to be used by anyone in Indonesia, with the healthcare infrastructure that the government is putting in place, with all the patient data that are being collected in hospitals, so that actually you can really benefit from seamless integration. So that's something that we are very passionate about. We are the biggest healthcare informatics player, and also the only one that's multi-vendor and open, because we believe in an open ecosystem approach. Where we are part of the solution, we are not the only solution. And that's, I think, how we can accelerate the journey. And then maybe last point is, if you think about AI, the power of AI comes from technology that we have, the data that the provider has, and the framework that the government has. That together fuels AI to really do the things that we want to do. So actually, the collaboration of us determines how successful we will progress in healthcare and AI.
So to close this, any last word towards a cohesive plan in building a sustainable and interconnected health system through digital transformation? Sure, and please start with you, Mr. Satyaji.
Just do it.
Just do it. From Ms. Carol?
I think it's very clear what needs to be done. I think we just need to be consistent. I'm with Satyaji. I think we just have to execute on it.
Okay, Mr. Yakov.
Be fast and be furious.
Fast and furious. Well then, give a big round of applause to our speakers. So I think as a conclusion, we've discussed the challenges that we're facing in Indonesia. Ms. Caroline shared a very valuable insights from her experiences, highlighting the need for timely and equitable healthcare. Mr. Satyaji update us on the country's digital transformation efforts, showcasing the progress made and benefits gained, while also pointing out the opportunities and challenges of embracing AI and data. Mr. Royakov aided a global perspective, noting the positive impact of digital health and identifying key areas of improvement, showing us that prioritizing technology, education, and workforce development is essential for progress. And to be succeed, we must collaborate across the healthcare ecosystem. And by working together, we can create a sustainable and connected health system through digital transformation. And let's commit to this goal for a healthier future for everyone in Indonesia. And I think that's the end of our discussion. What a wonderful discussion. Thank you very much for our speakers. Please give a big round of applause to our speakers. What a truly enriching. It's an honor for me to share the stage with you all. And hopefully our discussion will bring an impact to you all, to everyone who has attended this event. And I would also like to express my gratitude to the media colleagues and distinguished guests who have attended today's event. I hope today's discussion provides valuable information for everyone and certainly contributes to advancing the provision of the best healthcare services for all the communities in Indonesia. And following this, there will be a photo session for the panelists. However, please allow me, Shafinaz Nasyad, to take my leave at this time, and I look forward to seeing you at the future's event. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I'll see you on the next event. Bye bye. I would like to invite Ms. Astri Ramayati Darmawan as the President Director of Philips Indonesia to come to the stage to take the pictures together with all the speakers. And members of the media are kindly invited to come forward to capture this moment.
Okay, to the speakers, you may see to the right side first. All the speakers, you may see to the right side first. Okay, right side first. You may see to the right side first. You may see to the right side first. Okay. Okay, now to the center. Now to the left side.
Yeah. Okay.
And I would like to invite Mr. Edwin to come to the stage.
Untuk gue, untuk meja.
Okay, we invite Philip's representative to come to the stage to have another photo session together. Okay, now first session, go to the center first, to our main photo. Okay, to the center first, got our first picture. Okay, now to the left.
To the right side.
Okay, thank you everyone. Thank you.